Hello everybody. Let me first thank the organizers for organizing the meeting and for accepting my talk. I am Marcos. I work in the Donosti International Physics Center in the Basque Country at the north of Spain. Let me show you a picture of San Sebastian, Donostia. We work in this amazing city. I work in the group led by Raul Angulo, and I'm going to talk to you in this talk about the work that we have been making in the last year or so, in which we try to explain the large-scale galaxy structure through bias expansion and embodied simulations. And the work is based mostly on this paper here that you will see here. So I just hope that you enjoyed the talk as much as I enjoyed preparing it. So let's get to it.
Okay. So what we want to do is to know what is going to be the distribution of galaxies in the universe. Now, there's like one first issue that we need to address, which is the fact that in cosmology we know very well how to predict the distribution of dark matter. So we know very well how it will be distributed with this typical structure of sheets connecting into filaments and filaments connecting into knots. But the problem appears when one goes and tries to measure this structure. Because what we see is not the dark matter itself, but some tracers of this dark matter. Let's assume that these tracers are galaxies for now. So we will see actually some galaxies following this structure of dark matter. But how do they follow it? It's not a one-to-one relationship. So in order to put some maths into it, the object that we know how to predict very well in cosmology, thanks to the theory or to embodied simulations, is actually the density or the overdensity of dark matter as a function of time. But what we would like to predict is actually the overdensity of galaxies as a function of time. Now, in general, there are three main ways in which one can do this, as I already wrote here. A first one, which is kind of like what I call a full approach, which is an approach in which what you do is you put all of the material that you're interested in. So you put gas, baryonic gas, or stars, or anything, and then you evolve everything within an embodied simulation all together. So in this part, things like hydrodynamical simulations will come into play. The problem of this is that it's super expensive computationally. So there's a second approach, which is more practical, which basically starts with an embodied simulation, but only dark matter simulation, and tries to populate it with the objects that you are interested in, so with galaxies, according to some prior prescriptions that one gets from either hydrodynamical simulations or directly from observations. And here we will have, for example, things like HODs or SAMs. But there's a third approach, which is kind of like more theoretical, in the sense that it is based on theoretical grounds and tries to actually find out what is the function that maps this overdensity of galaxies with this overdensity of dark matter. So what it tries to do is actually to write down the overdensity of galaxies as a function of the overdensity of dark matter. So let's start with that. Let's start with that mapping. In order to see this mapping easier, what we're going to do is we're going to assume that we are in the initial conditions space. So when all of the fields in cosmology are Gaussian, This is also called the Lagrangian space, so we are going to be using these Lagrangian coordinates. The truth is that Lagrangian space is like some rescaling of time with of these initial conditions, but we won't care about this that much now. So since all of the fields are Gaussian, in principle this connection will be easier to find. And it's been shown that, at least from the point of view of endpoint statistics, endpoint function like the correlation function of the power spectrum or bispectrum, one can write down this overdensity of galaxies in Lagrangian coordinates as an expansion, a power law expansion of this overdensity of dark matter. So something like 1 plus some constant delta of matter to the 1 plus some other constant times delta of matter squared, and so on and so forth. Now there's another way of looking at this equation. One can see, yes, okay, it's expansion in powers of this delta for large scales, so this only works for large scales. But another way of seeing it is, wait, what I'm defining here is a basis to span all possible configurations in the galaxy overdensity space. So in the same sense as in algebra we have like vectors defining space, here we will have these fields defining that space. So the basis will be given by the overdensity of dark matter to the power of 1, the overdensity of dark matter to the power of 2, and all subsequent powers. So what we can write more general is that this delta of galaxies in Lagrangian space is some linear combinations of some operators with their own constant and the sum over them in Lagrangian coordinates. Okay, so and how are we going to construct these operators? Well, we know several quantities that have to affect this structure, like the tidal field. But what we are going to do is we are going to accept, in principle, any basic or easy operator that satisfies Galilean invariances. And what we are going to do is, once we have that, what we are going to use as an ansatz is that this is a correct expansion of that. So this equation here will be the ansatz that we will be using for this. As you can see, we have also the Lagrangian density field, matter density field to the power of 1, the Lagrangian matter density field to the power of 2, but we also have the tidal field component, which is defined here, and you see that is the tidal field because it's a double derivative of the gravitational potential, and some higher derivative term, which in this case is going to be only the Laplacian of delta. So we are stopping here at second order in this Bayes expansion. So great, now we have this ansatz, and we know how the galaxies, the overdensity of galaxies, is related to the overdensity of dark matter in the initial conditions. So what we need now is actually the time evolution of this, how this evolves with time. And let's go and see how are we going to solve this. Okay, so for the time evolution, what we're going to be using is the fact that we can go from Lagrangian coordinates to any other resift or to Eulerian coordinates by the mapping, by the Lagrangian mapping, which is given by this equation. So it's just a transformation that goes from initial conditions to any resift by means of the displacement field. Okay, so if we use conservation of mass over this change of coordinates, we get the following equation. We get that the density in Eulerian space is going to be the same as the integral over the volume in Lagrangian space of that density, but only in those places that satisfy that Their Eulerian coordinates are given by the Lagrangian coordinates plus the displacement field of that Lagrangian coordinates. Now, if we move to Fourier space, we can write this down as 1 plus delta g of k is the integral over q of 1 plus delta of galaxies of q. And now we have moved to Fourier space, but we are going to use the definition of the Dirac delta to make that integral. So this will be times the exponential of minus I k q plus psi. And that's it. Now we have the of a density of galaxies at any time given some displacement field. Usually this displacement field is computed through perturbation theory, but that's not what we are going to do. What we are going to do is we're going to assume that this displacement field is given by some n-body simulation. So, okay, let's recap a little bit. So the model that we have connects the dark matter of a density in the initial conditions space to the galaxy or the proto-galaxies in the positions in the initial condition space, or in Lagrangian space. Now we have an equation to evolve those galaxy positions, in which we actually assumed that those galaxies are going to follow the dark matter particles they are composed of. And we know where to get all of these fields. So we will get these fields from some n-body simulation. Okay, so then what is the second issue here? Okay, so we have a model that depends on n-body simulations. So if one wants to do cosmological analysis with this model, one encounters very fast the problem that n-body simulations are very slow. So the problem is that this model is too slow to do any kind of cosmological analysis, to vary omega matter, or to vary sigma 8, or any kind of cosmological parameter that one is interested in, because one will need one n-body simulation per cosmological parameter. Okay, so this is the second issue, but there's a solution to this too. And the solution consists in two main points. The first point is trying to make like n-body simulation as cheap as possible. But by not running an n-body simulation. What one can do is actually one can scale an n-body simulation. This was studied by Angulo and White in 2009, and it's basically a set of transformations that gets you from some n-body simulation that you have run previously, so this is an n-body, with some cosmology, so omega matter 1, for example, and then it finds the set of transformations that this n-body simulation needs to get to another scaled n-body simulation, so scaled n-body. With another cosmological parameter or other cosmological parameters. So, for example, omega matter of 2. This is very powerful because you only need to run one n-body simulation, and then in the space of the cosmological parameters, for example, let's say omega matter sigma 8, you start with one n-body simulation here, for example, this is an n-body, and then you can start populating the space from this n-body And you can start exploring this space from just one embodied simulation without having to run the other three in this case. Now, the problem is that in order to actually make likelihood estimations and do MCMCs and actually constrain these parameters, even though this is way cheaper than running an embodied simulation, it's still too slow. So we need something over this. And what we used was building an emulator. That's the second point. That's the second part. And we did this in Tenaro et al. 2021. And this consists on training a neural network to actually be able to interpolate between the points of the scaled embodied simulations. So the idea is that we have the same parameter space. We have the scaled embodied simulations. And now the neural network is able to interpolate between all of these for quantities like, for example, the power spectrum or correlation function. So good. Now we have the model. We have speed this up fast enough so that we can do cosmological inferences. So let's see what are the results that we got. First, the ability of the model to reproduce the two-point statistics at the level of the power spectrum and the cross spectrum between the density of dark matter and the density of galaxies within 1% all the way down to k of about 0.78 of a megaparsec. This actually answers the question on how large are the large scales. And the answer is that for this model, large scales go all the way down to 0.78 of a megaparsec. But not only that, we checked if the model was consistent within itself by fitting the model to different Kmax, to different scales. So we fitted the model down to k of 0.1, k of 0.3, k of 0.5, and k of 0.7. And within the errors of the given sample, we are sure that the model is consistent with it within itself. So now we have a model that is able to fit down to quite small scales, that it is consistent within itself, and that it is able to do some cosmology. Thanks to the scaling technique and to the emulator, we are able to do likelihood estimation in matter of milliseconds, which allow us to actually do cosmological constraints in a matter of few hours. So now we have a model able to go down to the smallest scales that these kind of theoretical models have been able to go to, and able to predict, well, to do some parameter estimation. And this is awesome. But we didn't stop there. We were interested too in how such a model will perform if including some recessive space distortions, so some velocity information. And this is just a quick preview of what is to come. And it's the fact that this model going to recessive space is also able to fit the monopole, quadrupole, and hexadecapole of a galaxy-like sample down to scales of 0.68 of a megaparsec.
This is the end of the talk. I apologize for any kind of typos that I might have had, but this is the first time I do this kind of talk. And thank you very much for listening until the end. I hope we can discuss about these findings in the meeting. Thank you. Bye.